this is just the beginning. I'm still here.
I nailed your ass good, didn't I?
That's right, Lucas. And now it's my turn to watch you die.
This is Brian James. He was an American character actor who made his mark in the 80s and 90s as a big, tough guy villain in many movies. Born in 1945, he trained with Stella Adler in New York before venturing out to California in the late 70s to find acting work. Brian was a wild performer, always channeling a crazy energy into his characters. His filmography is a great mix of enjoyable cult movies and mainstream studio pictures. This is some of his work. When he started out, Brian was often cast as a barnyard heavy, which meant a stereotype redneck villain, appearing in TV shows like The Little House on the Prairie and Roots.
He know my master, Master Greaves. I ain't no runaway. I was thrown off the plantation. These are slave stealers. They stole me away to sell me south. Tell my master, tell Master Greaves!
Ah! Here, get out of here. Don't pay him no mind. Lying niggas say anything. You hear me? Get!
Yes, sir, boss. Get now.
As the new decade of the 1980s turned in, his talent and special look would make him attractive for casting directors in search for interesting bad guys.
Did you leave him with the money?
Oh, I want it.
They made. I want a shot to get it back.
Fuck you, Commodore. I want this money. All right?
Oh, son of a bitch.
I'm not gonna kill y'all if I don't got to. I got a bayou over here. Take it. Stay to the west side. You wanna find a road about a mile up there.
Do you mind telling us what's going on?
It's real simple. We live back in here. This is our home and nobody don't fought with us.
What about him?
What about him?
Did he do it to himself or did your friends help him out?
If I was you all, I'd quit asking questions and haul ass. But my buddies, they're not nice like me.
Are we supposed to say thanks?
You're not supposed to say nothing, soldier.
Southern Comfort marked the first collaboration between Brian and director Walter Hill. They ended up doing four movies together. 48 Hours was one of them.
Nick Nolte, Eddie Murphy.
We ain't brothers, we ain't partners, and we ain't friends. Now, if Gans gets away with my money, you're gonna be sorry you ever met me.
I'm already sorry.
48 Hours.
I know I have not been acting real great.
Hey, Jack.
Yeah?
I almost forgot that pal of yours from the Vice Squad wants you to call him.
Huh?
Said he roused at a bar with you last night.
Well, why in the hell didn't you tell me that before?
Hey, I'm not paid to take your personal calls.
Well, what's the goddamn number, Keo?
It's on my desk. Find it yourself. It's under the light.
In 1982, Brian became part of sci-fi history with his supporting role in Ridley Scott's masterpiece, Blade Runner. He plays the replicant Leon, who is the first character introduced in the movie. The role was originally written as a black character, but this was later changed after Brian came in and read for the part. It proved to be the most recognizable role of his entire filmography.
They're just questions, Leon. In answer to your query, they're written down for me. It's a test designed to provoke an emotional response. Shall we continue?
Describe in single words only the good things that come into your mind. About your mother?
Your mother?
Yeah.
Let me tell you about my mother.
Earlier today, you were asked, did you know it was going to be popular? I seem to remember that the movie, I was a big fan of the movie when it came out, pretty much tanked when it came out, and now has acquired this incredible reputation in the years since. When you
I
were,
tanked
too. You tanked for that. But it's such...
Actually, it didn't tank, but it was moderate. People were expecting, they didn't know what to do. They thought it was going to be like a Star Wars-y kind of faggy space movie.
No!
You know, one of those. Yeah.
Wake up. Time to die.
...1985 proved to be a strong artistic year for Brian. First up, he played a comical bad guy in Sam Raimi's Crime Wave. A wacky screwball comedy, which was also written by the Coen brothers.
Nonsense immediately! Put her down this instant, you filthy little man!
Who's gonna stop me, you old bat? You and those fag dogs?
That's right!
After Crime Wave, Brian flew over to Spain and joined the cast of Flesh and Blood, the first English language film by the legendary Dutch director Paul Verhoeven. The movie was co-produced by Orion Pictures and serves as a bridge between Verhoeven's European work and his future Hollywood career. Flesh and Blood is a dirty and depraved medieval film without the glamour and heroism usually associated with the genre. The production was plagued by tensions between the actors and the crew. According to a biography written about Verhoeven in the 90s, Brian was often late to the set and also had a physical altercation with the Dutch producer of the film, throwing a chair at him in a fit of rage. In this interview from the late 90s, Brian talks candidly about his experiences working on the movie.
Well, actually, it was probably the worst experience of my life.
Oh, okay.
6 days a week, 15 weeks, cold, freezing, the coldest winter in Spain in 30 years. It snowed in the castle we were working in. We all had this chest crud disease. And I fought with Verhoeven every day.
You stupid clot. You didn't want us to leave last night. But we still had the chance. You were too busy playing the fucking saint.
Easy. What do you mean, too easy? The plague isn't going easy for Celine. Cursed! I'm being led.
Led by your cock. Prancing around in white with that slut.
And now you've led us all to hell, you bastard!
The movie, the subject of the movie, and it actually came out to be the best movie about the 15th century I've ever seen, but it wasn't worth it. Every one of us wanted to quit the business at the end of that film.
Red Scorpion is a wild Rambo knockoff, where Dolph Lundgren plays a Russian super soldier who defects to the other side. It was produced by the notorious Washington lobbyist Jack Abramoff and shot on location in the deserts of Namibia.
Bang, bang, rock and roll. Bang, bang, rock and roll.
Ah!
Are you out of your mind?
No. Just out of bullets.
Do I smell heroin? What's this?
Come on, man.
You bring this into the police
station? Wait a fucking minute. You planted that shit.
That's disrespectful. You know that?
This is distribution way.
Fucking cop setup. You're fired, asshole. You know who I got on retainer?
Clean heads deal who, when, and where.
Lawyer I got makes ACLU look like Nazis. He lives for cop misconduct like this. Probably sue you for fucking free.
Yeah?
And I ain't telling you shit.
No! No! Jeez, no! Shit! Okay.
Funny thing happened to me on the way to the studio today. I saw a lady and a baby hit by a truck.
The Horror Show was reportedly Brian's favorite role of all the bad guys he created. He plays a vicious serial killer who is captured and executed. But his spirit returns back to life to get revenge on the detective who caught him, played by Lance Henriksen. You would think that pairing these two badass actors together would be a dynamite combination. But the movie gets hampered by a weak script, but feels more like a Nightmare on Elm Street ripoff than anything else. But despite all this, the execution scene is pretty memorable, and it lets Brian go completely off the rails.
All that did was give me a hard-on.
Increase the voltage.
Yeah, increase the voltage, shithead! Yeah! Yeah!
I'm gonna tear your world apart. Coming back to fuck you up.
Also in the same year, Brian joined the cast of the 80s action extravaganza Tango and Cash with Sylvester Stallone and Kurt Russell. The production was hampered by constant reshoots, creative disagreements, and behind-the-scenes meddling by the crazy super producer John Peters. Brian plays the menacing henchman Requin, who displays a distinct Cockney accent throughout the entire movie.
You fucking wanker!
He did this to stand out from all the other cast members, and to make a memorable impact on an otherwise stock villain character.
Don't panic.
Taunty Tango. You're a pretty boy, aren't you?
I'm panicking.
How'd you like me to change it for you?
I wouldn't.
Plan A.
This party's really fun.
Come on, you mean puppet, who pulls your strings?
Piss off. Bollocks to plan A. I like this. It feels great up here.
In the summer of 1990, Brian appeared in the sequel for 48 Hours, reprising his role from the first film. It's a misfire of a sequel, rehashing just old bits from the first movie, and the story feels disconnected. It is hastily revealed in the last 20 minutes that Brian's character is in fact the main villain Iceman, which the movie revolves around.
And we're gonna get the cop and the Iceman.
Brian's role was reportedly cut down after the studio insisted on a more box office friendly 90 minute runtime, cutting almost 25 minutes out of his character's backstory. Brian was not informed on this decision and only found out at the film's press screening. The snub destroyed his long working relationship with director Walter Hill, and they never made a movie together again.
Jack, we can work this out. Just let me out of here.
You're a disgrace, Ben. Nothing worse than a bad cop.
Hey, Jack, thank you for a very pleasant day. Okay? I got no car, I got no money, and I'm gonna fucking end the day off with this goddamn dope man's Uzi by my temple. Thank you, Jack. Look, this is Jack's day. Why don't you just let Jack shoot me? Save your bullets. Jack, why don't you shoot me? Shoot me, Jack!
Receiving the last rites. The DA discovers that the husband faked his own death. She's innocent. He races to the penitentiary, but it's too late. The pellets have dropped. She's dead. He helped kill the woman he loved.
Who are the stars?
No stars. Just talent.
No stars? What the fuck kind of ending do you call that? It's depressing. It'll bring everybody down.
Depressing? Joel, what about terms of endearment? Love story, Steel Magnolias, Joel, E.T. Gross, what, Marty? $319 million worldwide, pre-cassette, and there wasn't a dry eye in the house. Depressing? I don't think so.
Yeah, but...
Listen, normally I'd agree with you, but this is an entirely different kind of deal here. It is a matter of taking a risk, rolling the dice. But if they come up seven, bingo. It's Oscar time.
Did they screw?
Who?
The DA, whoever it is, and the woman, did they screw? If I'm going to be looking at jail cells and gas chambers, we're going to have a little sex in this mystery.
Oh, yeah, sure, of course. We'll get it there, no problem.
Okay.
Throughout the 90s, Brian's output was a mixed bag, amassing many, many credits in various straight-to-video B-movies, and occasionally a supporting part in a mainstream studio film. Brian once said, "Why be an actor if you're not going to act?" He seemed to enjoy the gypsy lifestyle of an actor, going from set to set, traveling and working all over the world. One of the best ones of his B-movies from this period is the 1992 sci-fi action film, Nemesis.
He is their nemesis.
In the movie, Brian is the sidekick to Tim Thomerson, who was a personal friend of his in real life. Their friendship translates well to the screen, and Brian adds a German accent for his character to have.
The taxi say it will take 6 to 12 hours to decode the scrambler Julian put in him.
Nemesis has a lot of cool gunplay and awesome practical effects. The story and the acting doesn't always make sense, but at least the movie has a distinct cyberpunk identity of its own, and proves itself to be an underrated entry in the 90s science fiction canon. Brian lived a hard life, with drugs and alcohol and a constant work over his shoulders. In August of 1999, his lifestyle finally caught up with him, and he suffered a fatal heart attack at the age of 54. Brian was really one of the last breed of gruff, old-school character actors who excelled in creating memorable bad guys. His career never elevated him to something bigger, but his filmography is a rich reminder of his talent and the crazy energy he transfused into every role he played. He may be gone from this earth, but he still lives forever in the movies he left behind.